Yesterday, we asked the president about this, along with many other issues. Tonight, we're running fewer commercials and airing our extended interview with the president. Here's part one of that conversation. Mr. President, thanks for doing this.
Thank you.
The reaction to your press conference in Washington was swift and intense. Former CIA Director John Brennan described it as treasonous and a potentially impeachable offense. Why the push toward conflict with Russia in Washington on both sides?
Well, I think Brennan's a very bad guy, and if you look at it, a lot of things happened under his watch. I think he's a very bad person. I also think that when you watch Peter Strzok and Lisa Page, when you watch all of the things that have happened, and happened Comey, take a look at that, and McCabe, who's got some pretty big problems, I assume. You look at the deception, the lies, what's gone on in the last fairly long period of time, before I won. I mean, long before I won, during the campaign, I guess probably during the Republican, you know, when I was fighting against 17 other Republicans. So this has been going on for a long time, but these are people that, in my opinion, are truly, they're bad people. And they're being exposed for what they are. And it's a shame that it has to happen, but it's really hurt our country.
Their view is that the United States is forever in conflict with Russia, which is our chief global adversary, and anyone who doesn't believe that is betraying the United States. Without taking up whether that's true or not, why do you think there is this bipartisan consensus on that in Washington?
Well, it's sort of incredible, because you look at World War I and World War II, that was Germany, and in World War II, Russia lost 50 million people and helped us win the war. And I was saying to myself the other day, I said, you know, Russia really helped us. I'm not pro-Russia, pro-anybody. I just want to have this country be safe. I don't want nuclear weapons, even people thinking about it. You know, Russia and the United States control 90% of the nuclear weapons in the world. And getting along with Russia, and not only for that reason, that's a good thing, not a bad thing.
Are they our chief adversary, would you say?
Well, they're strong military, but their economy is much smaller, as you know, than China. And I don't want to even use the word adversary. We can all work together. We can do great. Everybody can do well, and we can live in peace. But I think it's very, very important, you know, and I've watched your show a lot, and I see how you're talking about the really the magnificent size of China. You look at the size and what they've done in a fairly short period of time. That's because of a lot of bad leadership on behalf of the United States. We allowed that to happen. We allowed them to make hundreds of billions of dollars. And right now, as you see, and you probably have noticed, that things are happening. We have to bring it more into line. We have to level the playing field between the United States and China. And we've increased our net worth. We've increased our worth by more than $7 trillion since the election. And we're about twice the size of China, our economy. But China still is a massive economy. They have the second biggest by far.
So NATO. NATO was created chiefly to prevent the Russians from invading Western Europe. I think you don't believe Western Europe's at risk of being invaded by Russia right now. So what is the purpose of NATO right now?
Well, that was the purpose. And it's okay. It's fine. But they have to pay. And they weren't paying. And other presidents went and they'd make a speech and then they'd leave and nothing would happen. And, you know, the fact that they didn't pay is not, you know, new. It's not a new fact. This is something that people have known for a long time. Other countries were delinquent. You know, in the real estate business, we use the word delinquent. They didn't pay. They didn't pay for past. So I went there 3-4 days ago, and I said, folks, you got to pay, because we're not going to pay from 70 to 90, and I think 90 is really the right, you know, depending on the way you define it, 90%. We're not going to pay 90% of the cost to defend Europe. And on top of that, the European Union kills us on trade. We lost $151 billion last year on trade. They don't take our product. They don't take our farmers' beautiful goods. They don't take our cars. And if they do, the rate of tax is many times what we would charge them. We only charge them 2.5%. Their tax, their tariff is very substantially higher. I mean, in the case of China, we charge 2.5% when they send a car. And when we send a car into China, they charge us 25%. How is that fair trade? You know, people say, oh, we want to keep, we don't want tariffs. But how is that fair when one country gets 25% and another country gets 2.5%? And by the way, the one getting 25% doesn't even want the cars. They want them to build those factories. They want those factories built in China. They want those factories built in Europe. So now we're doing things that have never been done before in this country, and you see what's going on. It's been very pleasant to watch.
So membership in NATO obligates the members to defend any other member that's attacked.
That's
so
right.
Let's say Montenegro, which joined last year, is attacked.
Right.
Why should my son go to Montenegro to defend it from attack? Why is that?
I understand what you're saying. I've asked the same question. You know, Montenegro is a tiny country with very strong people.
Yeah, I'm not against Montenegro
right.
or Albania.
No, by the way, they're very strong people. They're very aggressive people. They may get aggressive. And congratulations, you're in World War III. Now, I understand that, but that's the way it was set up. Don't forget, I just got here a little more than a year and a half ago.
Right.
But I took over the conversation 3 or 4 days ago, and I said, you have to pay. You have to pay. And the Secretary General said that because of President Trump, last year, we had an additional $44 billion, with a B, billion dollars raised for NATO. And this year, it's going to be much more than that. And the countries all agreed. It was very unfair. They weren't paying. So we're not only are we paying for most of it, but they weren't even paying. And we're protecting them. Add that to your little equation on Montenegro.
As you traveled around Europe and looked at Europe over the years, can you think of a place that has been improved by mass immigration or the movements of large numbers of refugees?
Not one.
Not one.
And in fact, one of my big things, and some people were insulted. I'll say a year ago, they would have been totally insulted. Now, maybe there could have been a couple out of all of those countries. I said, the immigration policies in Europe are a disaster. You're destroying Europe. You're destroying the culture of Europe. The crime is up in those areas. And you better do something. I tell them that. I said, look, it's not me. It's not anything. You just look at the numbers. The numbers speak. But the culture is changing rapidly, and the crime rate is changing more than rapidly. You better do something. I told them that.
What are the lessons for us watching that?
Well, we have to be very strong on the border. Now, we're much stronger than we ever were on the border, and our numbers are much lower. But still, we're getting the wall. We're putting in for about $5 billion. We've already started the wall, $1.6 billion. It started in San Diego, California. It's almost completed in that area. And by the way, the people were really asking for it. You know, it's interesting. They probably go down as, oh, we don't want the wall. But when it came to their backyard, they wanted that wall and they wanted it up fast. But we've started the wall. We are going to continue with the wall. It's so necessary. But we have to have strong immigration policies. Our laws are so bad, Tucker. Somebody comes in and they step on our land. And now we end up with a court case that takes 7 years, but the people never show up to court. It's so bad, and we have to do something about it. Like, if they come into our land, we have to say, I'm sorry, you have to leave. Not, I'm sorry, please come to court. We're going to put you in court. You'll come back in 3 years for your trial, and then they never show up. That's what's happening now. It's crazy.
Why do you think so many political and cultural leaders in the United States disagree with you and are making the case that borders are themselves immoral?
It's incredible. I mean, the Democrats are for open borders, which means crime. It's not a question of, like, you know, what do you think it means? Open borders means crime. And you look at MS-13 is pouring in, and we stop them better than anybody else could. But when they get through, and then we send ICE, because ICE is tougher than they are. And now I understand there's a big move to try and get rid of ICE. But MS-13, these are tough, vicious people. They don't like guns. They like using knives better because it's more painful. These are vicious people. And you know the story. You cover it plenty. And ICE goes in and they get them out. They get them out. They put them in jail or they throw them out of the country and they don't even think about it. And now there's a move on to get rid of ICE because ICE is tough. If you don't have tough people doing that job, you're going to have crime like you've never seen it. So it is incredible. The Democrats want open borders, which is basically saying we want open borders, we want crime.
Why do you think they want that?
Maybe it's a political philosophy that they grew up with. Maybe they learned it at school. Maybe they're fools. I don't know.